Good afternoon. Welcome to StatSoft webinar for the pharmaceutical industry. This time we will focus on product quality monitoring and evaluation. My name is Karol Suchowski. At StatSoft, I'm responsible for working with key clients in the pharmaceutical and biotech industries. Today's webinar will be hosted by Dr. Marek Skowronek, the head of a team of consultants and analysts providing content-related support in the form of training, consulting, and development of solutions in the field of data analysis for the pharmaceutical industry. Today's webinar will last for approximately 1 hour. At the beginning of the webinar, I will briefly introduce StatSoft's solution for the pharmaceutical industry. Then Marek will discuss the issues related to product quality monitoring and present the next step of ongoing process verification according to Annex 15. From preparing a verification plan, verification execution, evaluation of verification results with recommendations, to preparation of the report. The webinar will introduce the basic concept of training and statistical analysis methods used to identify unusual undesirable trends in product quality evaluation. Furthermore, we will show how to perform the evaluation of product quality and prepare the report in accordance with current requirements using one of the database solutions prepared by StatSoft. During the webinar, you can ask questions in the chat. We will answer your questions in a QA session at the end of the webinar. Now, I will tell you a few words about our company and its solutions for the pharmaceutical and biotech industries. For 25 years now, StatSoft has been supporting companies in a highly regulated pharma industry, providing software and sharing knowledge through training and consultation. The solutions we provide are present in many European countries. ...2019 provided to be the breakthrough year for our business, when StatSoft Poland joined forces with StatSoft Europe. By leveraging the potential of both of our teams in Krakow and Hamburg, we can offer a wider range of solutions, including ones in areas of predictive modeling and machine learning. Our offer to the pharmaceutical industry in terms of data analysis and reporting is even more comprehensive, and includes not only the solutions developed in Krakow, but also implementation of advanced TIBCO solutions. We are known primarily as a proven provider of analytical and reporting system and advanced IT solutions. We develop and implement systems for collecting, storing, sharing, and analyzing data. We support you in all steps of analytical projects related to data science. We provide and adopt TIBCO software to your needs and set up a business solution for you. And last but not least, we offer a wide range of training courses on statistical software and data science. When it comes to pharma industry, StatSoft Poland developed add-ons embedded in statistical software to facilitate statistical data analysis and reporting in various GMP areas to include product quality monitoring to evaluate the technological process during product quality review or ongoing process verification. Process validation to evaluate validation batches and their equivalency during process validation. environmental monitoring to evaluate physical, chemical, and microbiological data collected for clean rooms and installations. This solution profile comparison using various model-dependent and model-independent methods. Proficiency testing to assess laboratory performance based on inter-laboratory research. Measurement uncertainty calculated using theoretical model as well as validation study results. Analytical method validation to evaluate validation characteristics as per ICH. And finally, product stability with evaluation of shelf life based on the long-term and short-term studies with identification of atypical trends during ongoing stability program. Additionally, we have prepared a tool that facilitates compliant reporting and analysis for bioequivalence studies. Analytical add-ons can be extended to include a database for collecting and storing data with real-time identification of atypical trends. Stacksoft also created advanced database system that allow you to collect, analyze, store, and share information related to product quality monitoring, stability studies, and environmental monitoring. Our system allows to collect of data from various sources, storing them in a common analytical database, and sharing the information by sending notification after identification of adverse events with real-time process visualization and reporting. In 2020, with the support of EU funds, Stacksoft Poland developed a system that integrates all stages of the product lifecycle, starting with research and development, through validation of the process and ongoing process verification during routine production. The system is both for research and development departments, which are interested in implementing the QPD approach for quality assurance or qualified person that want to monitor the process in real time with detection of atypical trends, as well as for technological departments dealing with improving the effectiveness of manufacturing process. Now I pass the floor to Dr. Marek Skowronek, who will discuss the basic methodology, procedures, and examples related to monitoring and evaluation of product quality. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask them using the chat. Marek, the floor is yours.
The second part of the webinar is dedicated to monitoring and evaluation of product quality. According to the GMP requirements, a state of control should be established and maintained by developing and using effective monitoring and control systems for process performance and product quality. The results of critical in-process control and finished product results should be reviewed at least every year during the periodic product quality review. This review often includes a retrospective statistical evaluation of process and product quality using control charts and capability indices. In addition to this, according to Annex 15, manufacturers should monitor product quality to ensure that a state of control is maintained throughout the product lifecycle with the relevant process trends evaluated to confirm the validated status of the product in the product quality review, including statistical evaluation of process and product quality. So, how to organize or combine statistical process control, ongoing process verification, and periodic quality review programs? First of all programs mentioned should be interrelated elements of the pharmaceutical quality system. How to do that? The first step is to develop a procedure for statistical process control, describing the main principles of the program, the methods of data analysis used, and interpretation of the results obtained. Statistical process control should be conducted on an ongoing basis with identification of out-of-specification results and atypical trends in real time. Then a procedure for ongoing process verification should be developed describing the principle of evaluation of the results collected during statistical process control. The extent and frequency of ongoing process verification should be reviewed periodically. The last step is to summarize the results obtained during ongoing process verification into the in the product quality review. Process verification involves four basic steps: preparation of verification plan, execution of verification plan, evaluation of verification results, and generation of report. Stage 1, verification plan. As per Annex 15, ongoing process verification should be conducted under an approved protocol or equivalent documents. The first question to be answered is, what data information should be collected to add value to the organization and the patient? First of all, data should be collected for parameters that are critical to safety, efficacy, and quality of the product. In addition, data should be collected for parameters that are technologically important and the analysis of which will improve the effectiveness of the technological process by reducing waste and shortening the production cycle time. How to select critical key quality and performance attributes? Firstly, we can ask if the attribute impacts efficacy and safety of the product. If yes, it is a critical quality attribute. If not, we can ask if the attribute impacts process performance. If yes, it is a key performance attribute. If not, it's neither critical nor key attribute. The critical and key attributes can be further divided into attribute of high, medium, or low impact. For instance, high criticality means that non-compliance of CQA with the acceptance criteria has a high impact confirmed on the efficacy and or safety of the drug product, based on, for instance, clinical studies. Moderate criticality means that attribute has a moderate impact, potential impact on the efficacy and or safety of the drug product, based on our experience. And low criticality means that it has a low impact indirect on the efficacy and or safety of the drug product. Example, the dissolution. The dissolution has a direct impact on the efficacy of the product bioavailability. Too long API release time from the drug formulation affects the bioavailability of the active ingredient based on in vitro in vivo correlation. Next step, how to select critical key process parameters. Firstly, we can ask if the parameter impacts critical quality attributes. If yes, it is a critical process parameters. If no, we can ask if it affects key performance attribute. If yes, the process is a key process parameter. If not, it is neither critical nor key parameter. The critical and key parameters can be further divided into parameters of high, medium, and low impact. For instance, high criticality means high impact of the parameter on the variability of the critical quality attribute. For instance, CQA can change more than 20% within the allowed specification range based on experimental studies. Moderate impact means CQA changes between from 5 to 20%, and low impact means that CQA changes less than 5% within allowed specification range. Example, particle size of the active substance variability has a high impact on quality attributes of high criticality dissolution. API particles that are too large can lead to slower release rate due to its low solubility in water. Based on experimental studies. So we have selected attributes and parameters to be monitored. Now we can prepare a detailed plan. The plan should define the type of control, meaning determine whether it's a routine process control defined in the technological documentation or non-routine additional one resulting from, for instance, post-validation recommendation. And then the plan should define type of data, whether they are qualitative at variables, for instance, appearance, identity, or quantitative, such as essay or weight. The plan should outline the data type, meaning whether raw or aggregated data will be collected, as well as methods of data recording, using database system or with traditional paper forms. The verification plan should also contain the specification, technological limits, and control limits if available, as well as provide methods for results evaluation, such as comparison to specification limits, evaluation of atypical trends, and assessment of process capability. The plan should reference a sampling procedure describing sample collection procedure, storage, and transportation. To sum up stage one in one sentence, select quality attributes and process parameters that are important to the organization and the patient. Define a verification plan considering the features of the data and the methods used to evaluate and record them. Define a sampling plan taking into account GMP principles related to sample collection, storage, and transportation. Stage two, verification execution. The following conditions must be met before the ongoing process verification plan can be executed. Criticality of product attributes and process parameters should be defined or updated. Technological and analytical documentation should be updated and be in line with the registration dossier. Programs for periodic qualification, maintenance, and calibration of equipment should be implemented, and environmental monitoring program should be implemented as well. In addition to this, monitoring program for analytical methods, for suppliers of starting packaging materials and training program should be implemented. And finally, ongoing process verification with statistical process control program should also be developed and implemented. Verification should be executed according to the approved plan. Changes to the approved verification plan shall be documented as a deviation. Each deviation should be assessed in terms of its impact on the verification result. Changes to the verification plan should be made in the new version. To sum up stage two in one sentence, verified preconditions to eliminate occurrence of non-process systematic error. Execute verification plan according to the approved verification plan. Record and document any changes to the approved verification plan as a deviation. Stage three, verification evaluation. In accordance with the requirements of Annex 15, statistical tools should be used where appropriate to support any conclusions with regard to the variability and capability of a given process and ensure a state of control. Now let's take a closer look at the basic principles of statistical process control. Once transferred to routine production, the process is exposed to long-term potential sources of variation related to changes in personnel, equipment, materials, environment, and procedures. Therefore, at this stage of life cycle, the objective is to identify, assess, and control sources of variation that may disturb the process and generate out-of-specification results. What are the type of variation that can occur in a process? We can distinguish between two types of variability: special variability resulting from cause and effects relationships and can affect the process significantly and generate a product being out of specification limits, and natural variability resulting from many cause and effects relationships, none of which is dominant in the process, but is responsible for the random variation of the results from batch to batch. Why is the distinction between special and natural variability so important? This is important because the type of action taken to improve the process depends on the type of variability that is present in the process. Variability resulting from special causes requires identification, elimination, and control of the source of variability and can be reduced without changing the process, whereas the reduction of natural variability requires change optimization of the whole process or some of its unit operations. However, in assessing variability, we can make two mistakes. The first one, called manufacturer risk, occurs when there are random causes in the process, but the manufacturer takes actions to identify the special cause, what is waste of time because there is no special cause present in the process. The second one, patient risk, is the case where the process is in fact out of control, but the manufacturer does not take any action, claiming that this is a natural variation, thus posing a risk to the patient, what results in generating waste as well. So how to keep the balance right between the manufacturer risk and the patient risk? The reliable way to separate natural from special variation is a control chart. A typical control chart consists of observations collected in chronological order and control limits, which include a band of natural process variation. As long as the points are randomly distributed within the control limits, the process shows a natural predictable variability. Points outside control limits and or non-random point configurations may indicate a special cause, potential source of variability that may affect the critical quality attributes. The control charts are effective and economically justified when the four assumptions are met. Assumption number one is related to application of the Three Sigma rule. Assumption number two regards correct determination of process sigma. Assumption number three says about implementing rational sampling and grouping. And assumption number four is about taking action to reduce variability in the process. Assumption number one, the control limits on the Schuart chart should be set at the distance of three sigma from the center line. Why? The Three Sigma rule was proposed by Schuart based on empirical studies, keeping a balance between manufacturer and patient risk. Limits defined this way allow special causes to be identified and action to be taken in cases that are economically justified without generating excessive false signals. These limits are also robust to violation of the assumption of normality of the data distribution, even for single observations. If data are homogeneous, meaning there is random variation present only, almost all points are contained within three sigma distance, regardless of the data distribution. Assumption number two, process sigma should be determined as the average of within sample dispersion statistics. Why? Process sigma used to set control limits should be a measure of the natural variability of the process, free from special causes. An effective way to determine the natural variability of a process is to estimate the process sigma based on the average value of the dispersion statistics of each sample. The statistic used to determine the dispersion can be the average value of standard deviations, ranges, or moving ranges. Assumption number three, a rational approach to sampling and grouping data should be used when creating control chart. Why? The way in which data are sampled and organized determines the questions that the control chart will answer. Samples should be drawn to minimize within sample variability, representing the natural variability of the process, and maximize between sample variability, increasing the chance of detecting a special cause. A rational approach to sampling and grouping should define what type of sources of variability in the process contribute to within sample, within batch variation, and what contributes to between sample, between batch variability. Assumption number four, implementation of statistical process control tools alone is not sufficient to improve the effectiveness of the organization. Why? Control charts are as effective as an organization uses the knowledge resulting from the implementation of statistical process control program. And this knowledge is only useful when it is the source of action. Hence, an effective statistical process control requires systematic building of process and product knowledge throughout the product lifecycle and continuous improvement of the process through identification, reduction, and control of sources of variability. When can a process be considered stable, predictable? A process can be considered stable, predictable, if it is possible to predict how the process will behave in the future within the assumed limits of variability based on the historical data collected. As long as the points are randomly distributed inside the control limits, the process exhibits natural predictable variability and each successive result does not differ significantly from those observed in the past. Points outside the control limits and or non-random points configuration may indicate a special cause, a potential source of variation. Having control chart generated, what are the criteria for assessing process stability? There are four zone tests that can be used to detect sudden changes in the process. First, one or more points outside the control limits beyond 3 sigma. It can indicate a special source of variation. For instance, it can result from production error, laboratory error, or incorrect setup of the equipment. The next one, zone A test, 2 out of 3 consecutive points in zone A, between 2 and 3 sigma or further, detects a large shift of the process, but still within control limits. May result from change of materials, personnel, equipment. The next one, zone B test, 4 out of 5 consecutive points in zone B, from 1 to 2 sigma or further, detects a small shift of the process, and it may result from change of materials, personnel, or equipment. And the last one, zone C test, 9 consecutive points on the same side of the center line of zone C below 1 sigma or further, detects a permanent shift of the process may result from change of campaign. In addition to zone tests, there are four tests that detect non-random patterns of points. For instance, trend test, 6 consecutive points increasing or decreasing. Stratification tests, 15 consecutive points in zone C below 1 sigma. This configuration occurs in cases of non-rational grouping of data. For instance, taking one sample from different processes, and this results in high within sample variability and as a consequence in wider control limits. Excessive control, 14 consecutive point changing up and down. This configuration occurs when there is a sequence of repeated systematic changes as a result of regulation of a stable process or systematic change of equipment from batch to batch. This is limited to very specific cases. Mixture, 8 consecutive points outside zone C, above 1 sigma. The configuration can occur when there are several different processes from which independent samples are taken. This is limited to very specific cases.